laughter, madmen, stage left. The audience rises and holds their breath. They let the vampires into their house. Pretend they don't see when the teeth come out. Put a band-aid on their throat. No one wants to rock the boat. And no one wants to talk about it. You're not supposed to talk about it. And the players come out. Webs of lies spinning from their mouths. Stop looking, listen for a little while.
You don't see a very nice smile. Pay no attention to the men behind the curtain. Just look away when you see the blood spurting down to a steady drip. I promise to leave you a little.
Oh man, I knocked the camera off of Dustin. Hello everybody. We had to mess it up for somebody there, Dalton. So we got the microphone plugged in this time, but we couldn't have the camera out.
I'm rifting on the dimensional wave there. Just get this a
little bit. We gotta come over this way.
That's just that's an awful lot of view of the wall.
It is.
A lot of paint Floyd.
We had a lot of dog action going on in the room here right before the show started. I thought I managed to lead him out of here without bumping the camera stand, but apparently I did
maybe
not.
Maybe the dog did.
Something. I thought I kept him away from it, but I guess maybe he came through and hit it before.
He hits a snowplow, so I mean.
That's true. He plows everything away. If you've seen my dog Stock on the channel before, he's got a big fat head, big wide body. He looks like a couch with four legs on it walking around. So can you hear us, Dalton? Is that good enough for you? Have we pleased you? This is
a Pee Wee Herman couch dog.
Yeah. Yeah, kind of like that, but
kind of like Cherry.
Yeah. But it is Sunday.
A little more distempered than Cherry.
I would say, yeah, Cherry is has a little more joyful madness, where Stock is just he's fearful chaotic. And insane. Yeah. But he's getting better.
He's like a chaotic, you know, like the positive chaotic.
Yeah. I would say he's a chaotic neutral because he will bark at you and run at you. But if if there was a bad guy, I feel pretty sure he would run away from them barking at them, you know.
Like hey, get away from me.
He'd run up to them and bark and then back away as they, you know.
Do you need that closer?
What's that? Oh, yeah, probably so. But it looks like we're picking up pretty good. Dustin's voice is the softest, so it does tend to need to be closer.
Yep.
You suppose this is satisfactory? Well, thank you for your approval, sir. Well, it is. So glad to have you with us. My name is Cliff. I'm joined by Tim and Dustin as we go down the table. It is Sunday, November the 12th, 2023. We're a day after Armistice Day. You know, just hard to believe that 100 years ago, 105 years ago, whatever it was, they, you know, pretty much destroyed the world. And then 20 years later, they decided that wasn't good enough and needed to do it again. And it's like they're going to do that again. It seems like after another 80 years, you know, things have been going too good with us, you know, not destroying the whole planet. So they're going to be trying that again.
That whole definition of insanity. Yeah. Repeating the same thing over and over again, expecting different results.
You know what the funny thing is, though? Like, when Einstein said that, he was describing quantum physics, and he was trying to say, there's no way this works, because if that's the very definition of insanity, is doing the thing over and over again and expecting different results. But that's exactly what happens with quantum physics. And quantum physics are often one of the ways that... It's one of the plot devices that is used to introduce a parallel reality or alternate universe into a film or conspiracy theory, as it were. So that's what we're going to get into tonight, is a little bit of alternate universe, parallel existence, this kind of thing. And then we're also going to look back into another alternate reality from the Tri-Cities in the, you know, back in the 1800s, 1900s. It's going to be pretty cool. We're going to check that out. So we're going to be in an alternate reality of, you know, we're going to stay out of the reality tonight of the one where, you know, whatever's going on in the Middle East is hopefully not drawing in all the nations from all around the world. We're going to talk about what is on the other side of the veil, what is behind the curtain, so to speak, what may be lurking in the tiniest cracks and crevices of our reality, and maybe on such a small or such a large scale that we can, maybe we're like bacteria in the intestine of a giant, you know, worm or something.
Have you seen that macroscopic photography? Have you seen that? I saw the picture of the face of a jumping spider, and I thought that was cool. And today's Veterans Day, is that correct?
Yesterday was.
Yesterday's Veterans Day. Are you aware of what November 10th is, by chance? Goff.
No.
I'm only aware because people told me. It's the founding of the Marine Corps.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And
jumping spiders are kind of adorable.
Oh, yeah, they're super cute.
I think they are. I'd be terrified if it was even remotely close to the same size as it, but I think it's funny how they move and stuff. They kind of move like they're
a block. Yeah, they do a little dance and stuff. Yeah, they're pretty awesome. They do, here, I'm going to blow this up in another, whoops, not save
it. Is this photoshopped? Did they put the flowers in its eyes?
Yeah.
Surely.
They probably, if they...
Same picture.
I don't know, though. Look, though, it is a little different.
Well, you can...
And you can see the camera in it. Right, that's, they're peeking at it through the flowers with the camera. That's what that is. Hang on, folks. Sorry, we'll open this up so you guys can see what we're talking about here.
Pull it up, and it's just a picture of Pam Anderson's ass.
wait, wrong tab.
Sorry, that's my ass, guys.
Cliff's got daffodils on his ass tattooed.
There we go. That's a jumping spider with a macro lens right up in its face. Well,
macro's fun.
Yeah.
How many? It's like the thing is what... That always gets me. Like, I've tried to do it, you know, with like live insects. Mm-hmm. It's how to keep them still long enough to actually take the stack of photos, because that's probably like 100 shots compiled together.
Yeah,
that's how you get them so crisp looking. Because at those ranges, the depth of field is so shallow that like
like only like the tip of its eyes would be in focus. So you'd have to take like 20 shots just to get its eye in focus, to get its whole little head in focus.
So that's
like
not
that.
Just that's one like, camera that goes click.
Yeah,
it's like,
no, it's one camera going click, 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 and it's moving the focus ever so slightly to the edge of each part of the depth of field. Just like
how long would it take to do that, you think?
I mean, 100 shots, if you did them, you know, if you had a decent exposure, I mean, it would take like 30, 40 seconds, depending on your shutter speed.
Yeah, it's a long time for a jumping spider to sit still.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they literally jump.
Some of the bugs, sometimes they do use dead bugs, I've learned. But the ones that are, the ones that are alive, sometimes they lure them, they'll put like sugar water in front of them and they'll go and they'll
get them in one place.
Like a fly.
It'll make them.
We'll sleep for like 10 minutes. You can catch one doing that. And you can catch like a moth, will be pretty vacant for a while. A wasp will sit there and not do nothing. You can catch honeybees falling, or like bumblebees and honeybees falling asleep in flowers. Mm-hmm. But a jumping spider's not going all the time, so I don't understand that. It had to be dead.
That's Dalton, he does.
What's that?
He says you look like the missing link between
Looks like we're stepping down. So, get Cliff to be just a little bit shaggier, we'd have it perfect.
So, I'm a little thicker and have a shorter beard and so no hair. You're a little thinner than me. And then
it goes reverse with keratin when it's hair and shit. It goes this way. When it's weight, it goes that way. Actually, no. Me and Goff would have to, I think Goff's definitely heavier than me. I'm just going to pretend. There we go.
We're all pretty close to the same height, and I think, Dustin, it might be a little higher.
I am taller by a little bit.
I'm somewhere ghostly between 5'9 and 5'10. I'm pretty sure by looking at Goss about 5'11.
No, I'm actually over 6 foot.
All right. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty good at eyes. How much is that shoe, though?
Well, that's why I like my boots that I have, because my boots that I'm wearing right now put me at 6 feet. Like, normally I'm about 5'11, 5'10.
Oh, yeah. I mean, my shoes put me up to about a little over 5'10 to 5'11, but like I usually just don't really wear shoes with soles in them. So yeah. When you see me out, I usually am the exact same height because I usually have like basically barefoot, like when I'm wearing those Toms and stuff.
I usually wear boots because that's usually what I wear the most of at work, and that's what's broken in the most. So
Have you seen Boot Gate? I know we're not talking about
reality. DeSantis and his lift.
I've mentioned that to a few people, and it doesn't seem like it's hit the mainstream.
Yeah, it's only in political circles, really.
Is it? Okay. So that's about probably 2 months.
I mean, yeah, but so many people are paying attention to politics right now, and who's really paying attention to the Republican primary? I mean, Trump's so far the most popular. Oh, okay. Yeah. Like, have you ever heard anybody, like, talk about DeSantis or Vivek Ramaswamy or Nikki Haley?
None of those two, but DeSantis quite a bit.
I've heard some DeSantis talk because he was doing some good stuff in governor, and I've even talked some stuff about DeSantis because it seemed like Bill Lee was waiting. Everything that DeSantis did during COVID, Bill Lee would wait to see how his approval rating was after it, and then he would do it in Tennessee. So DeSantis was pretty popular in Tennessee because a lot of people would say to Bill Lee, hey, Bill, look what this guy's doing down in Florida. Don't be a pussy. You know, and so Bill would follow him after a little while. But at any rate, I don't see DeSantis yard signs. I don't see DeSantis, you know, flags. I don't see DeSantis. And I'm sure in Florida you would, but
I've seen some in Georgia and Florida both. But like, it makes sense it would be in Tennessee. Of course, I guess it would be really, really hard to get your name to spread beyond your home state, especially this far out from the actual president run. What were we talking about? The effects of heroin on a night out with a hooker? What were we talking about again?
Something like that, yeah. I don't remember the exact topic of discussion, but it was something pretty close to that.
Okay, so if the reptilians run our government...
Okay, I'm intrigued. Keep going.
So you could say the parallel universe to them would be the lot lizards that run the truck stops.
Oh, okay.
You know, that's pretty interesting. You talk about...
kind of like Sherlock Holmes's network of homeless people. Mm-hmm. All the lot lizards are secretly running the universe.
Well, yeah, I mean, I wasn't going to get into it a little bit later, but that till a little bit later it reminds me of, Tim, you I don't know if you have or not, Dustin, I can't remember if you said, but we talked Twin Peaks a few times on the show over the years. I don't know if you've seen any of those.
Not all. I've seen bits and pieces.
Well, the third season, The Return, that came out in 2017... It deals a lot with the concept of alternate reality alongside the Earth, or way, you know, what are they? Would they say gate waypoints between different realities in the show, or
you
something?
You really want me to ruin it for everybody?
No, I don't want you to do that just yet. But what I do want to say is that the alternate reality was something that was in there, and when you start seeing the alternate reality emerge, you see those woodsmen and like the beard, the filthy bearded men who start coming out of the ground and like hanging around a gas station. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty funny that you would mention the lot lizards, you know, hanging, you know, running the alternate universe. And that's kind of the theme of that show, is that the kind of ne'er-do-well nasty men running around the convenience store over top of the gas station are kind of the, what would you call them? Like the security, I guess, for the gateway or something like that.
I don't even know. Like David Lynch. I feel like I understand that series pretty good, but at the same time, David Lynch is so weird with his stuff that I'm afraid to speak with any authority on.
You wouldn't have to. Nobody really has any authority on it. Even David Lynch, you ask him about it, and he still doesn't tell you exactly what.
I've done a pretty good deep dive on it. Pretty much the premise of the show is, in this case, and you can still watch the show all the way from season one to the end. If you know this from the beginning, though, you'll it's kind of like watching Lost with some information. The entirety, turn it off if you're going to watch it, and you're going to get mad at me.
It's not going to affect it that bad.
The alternate universe that is so confusing to everybody else that's actually watching David Lynch's stuff. All that weird stuff is because the actual Twin Peaks show is a self-aware TV show. And that's why when the girl dies in the first episode, basically the entire episode is them crying, because David Lynch said the inspiration for the entire series was every week he turned on the TV and watched someone die. And within an hour, the world was like, that person no longer existed, because next episode, who gives a shit? Mm-hmm. And he was like, that's not the way it is in real life. When someone dies, an entire community is usually tore up for a decade. And he wanted to introduce a show where only one dead person is the main center of everything. And he said the networks almost lost their minds. They didn't think people could handle that level of attention span at the time.
Yeah, and they were kind of right. They barely finished the second season of the show.
Mm-hmm.
They actually stopped it.
Popped the cherry too early.
With four episodes left, they stopped it and just quit. But there was like 2 million people that watched it, and apparently enough of them wrote and said, "Hey, we were fucking watching that," and so they showed the rest of the episodes like a few weeks later, rest of the season a few weeks later. But
there's a lot of bad decisions in that too. David Lynch wouldn't have ruined it. One of the big things was revealing the murderer.
Yeah, they never wanted to tell.
He didn't want to tell anybody who it was, and they made him do it because they felt like fans are getting anxious. Turns out, since fans didn't care who it was, they didn't care to stick around for the rest of the episode. They're like, "Well, that's it."
Yep.
A side note, so you can get to your alternate universe, a just as complex and probably better alternate universe television show is The Amazing World of Gumball. Also a show where some of the characters are in a self-aware TV show.
I've seen some of that, but I never noticed. But I noticed, I was watching some of the Twin Peaks the other day, and there was a part where they describe a series of murders that's happened in a small town, and as they tell it to Miguel Ferrer, the FBI agent character, he says, "What do we got for season two?" And they all just kind of look at him, and he kind of like looks back at him in kind of a sly way, like he's talking, you know, to, like you said, I was kind of watching it from that mind point of, you know, trying to look at where Tim says they're self-aware. And I think that, you know, it's kind of part of it. Another alternate universe, and something like the movie like Flatliners, where, you know, these medical students allow themselves to die in a controlled setting so that they can experience like the world beyond.
Did they make that more than once?
They made a 2017 one. I've never seen it.
That was like in my head. It's like just a Mandela effect. Did they remake this?
But they go into, you know, an alternate world that reminded me an awful lot. That there's a Stranger Things alternate universe reminded me an awful lot of it. So if you had, where'd my picture of this go? There it is. So they had the Dungeons and Dragons, you know, mythos of an upside down, an alternate universe, you know, that was the mirror opposite of our own. And I'm pretty sure that that goes back. A lot of Dungeons and Dragons stuff is rooted in, you know, mythology from all over the world. So I'm pretty sure that goes back beyond Dungeons and Dragons too, especially the a lot of the ideas that were shown in the show Stranger Things. But you saw in that show where they basically would go to, in that version, the reality was just kind of darker and dirtier, and there were things out to get you that you couldn't see here.
It's almost like a take kind of on a Silent Hill's Nightmare World. That's kind of what I got off of, like how it looks, how the upside down always looks. It's like, it kind of reminds me of Silent Hill. Even though that's a completely different kind of vibe and theories with how Silent Hill works, but
you ever seen the movie From Beyond?
I have not. I've been wanting to.
It's on. I can't remember if it's Peacock or Paramount right now, but it's on one of those right now. And in that movie, they turn on a resonator that basically alternates. It puts out a magnetic field that affects everything around it and allows things from one reality to kind of be solid in another, where normally they wouldn't be there. So in the movie, these kind of eel fish things, when they first turn the machine on, they find that they're swimming in the air all around them and that they're actually there all the time, but they can't see us and we can't see them because we exist on a different wavelength of light, but not only light, but reality. Mm-hmm. And so when you vibrate these tuning forks at the right pitch, it allows, you know, us to kind of share the same space and kind of creates a reality where we can interface with that other reality. And that's kind of a lot of horror movies are based on these concepts and that are found in the Lovecraft stories, where there is, you know, beneath everything, like before everything was ever created, there were these great old ones or these dark astral beings that existed outside of time and space. And that somehow these things are, I think in Lovecraft, they're trapped beneath the mountains of Appalachia or something somehow. But there's also the extra dimensional part of it, where some of these things exist on a totally different plane from us, and we can't really interact with them and they can't interact with us. But some people are always, mad scientists it seems, always trying to do some sort of ritual or set up some sort of experiment to cross the pathway, because Our desire for knowledge is, you know, insatiable as human beings. And think about how many movies you see where they're like, oh, I've got to put on the helmet. No, stop, you'll explode your brain. You can't handle the information. They're like, no, I have to know. You know, think of Indiana Jones as like Crystal Skull when the chick there does it. Or, you know, in this movie. You see it over and over, and it's a trope in a movie for a reason, because people really do be like that, where, you know, it's just never enough. We have to know more. We have to know everything, you know. And so with that in mind, we hear a lot of modern, what you call conspiracy theories or whatever it is. I don't know if you'd even call it a conspiracy theory, but that's what it gets labeled. Where places like CERN, you know, are being used, because CERN is admittedly and quite publicly, proudly, trying to open gateways to other dimensions, you know, wormholes, black holes, this kind of thing. This is what they're trying to do, trying to discover the nature of reality and how the Earth was formed, where we came from. All these questions that, you know, we've had since the beginning of, you know, I don't know, whenever philosophy started, you know, people have been wanting to know where we came from. And they use, you know, the method of deduction to figure, well, this must be so, and this must be so, and God must be this, and this must be the way that life is, because this, 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 and this. And they take the number of things that they learned, and the facts that they knew, and the things that they could demonstrate, and they used them to try to understand the world and come up with ideas for what we might be, and where we might be, and why we might be here. And
most of the time.
Okay.
Most philosophers are doing it correctly. Then some of them get themselves in some weird predicaments, and you get entire fields like analytic philosophy, where people argue sentence structure for like 30 years.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're talking this history, yeah. Big picture philosophy, the idea in general.
Is, well, if you want to get that, you could use this little critter, this pink spermy dude that's swimming around next to the tuning forks. Mm-hmm. We can't normally see him or anything. Mm-hmm. Can you compare that to the allegory of the cave? Which is all the way back to the basics. Well,
and that's, well, that's where I was. Philosophy. That's where I was really getting to is, you know, it's the whole the allegory of the cave, that Descartes, I think, therefore I am. There's like, what plane of existence are we actually in? Are we in our own mind? Are we sharing the world? Are all of our minds interfacing with one another and creating a projection? You know, or are we just what amount of information do we have? Ultimately, decides. Where we think we are, and in the case of the cave, you know, the shadows on the wall were all the information they would have from the inside, and they felt like that was the whole world. But when they, you know, when an individual ventured outside of the cave, they saw there was a whole other world there. And of course, it's an allegory for the mind, but it's also could be taken to mean the physical realm too. So I think a lot of people have taken it that way, and you see stories coming about that all the time, all the way over to one of my favorite stories, The Dark Tower by Stephen King. It's, you know, different levels of reality combining to form basically a tower that holds all the, you know, levels of reality together, and that as you climb the tower, you step on different levels of reality. And
big Epcot.
What's that?
It's like a big Epcot scene.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah. Well, Epcot, you know, if you think about it, if you imagine that you were actually going to those places, Epcot is like a simulated, it's a virtual reality.
Virtual, try to trick us monkey see monkey doing to thinking the world's round. That's what they're trying to do.
Trying to think is...
Or is it, they're trying to send us a message that the real Earth is a hollow, leveled out Earth, and that they live inside of it. Or it's just a ball with, you know, Chinese food inside.
It's a yellow submarine.
You know, people use that. They try to say the Beatles were some kind of conspiracy people because of the whole yellow submarine thing, or the flat earthers like it. But then they forget that they ended it with Abbey Road, which has two songs that reference the earth being round.
Never one thought of about them, it.
Because the earth is round. There's another one I can't remember. But yeah. They're just doing drugs, guys. And something else I just want to bring up real quick about the Beatles. I've defended them quite a bit from music buffy people that want to give them a hard time. But I heard somebody say something today, and it just made something click in my head and go, well, yeah, of course, duh. Somebody said, yeah, the Beatles just changed music so much. They just took so many chances. Hold on a second. No. No, like... If you've got girls literally throwing their bras at your train while you're going down the road, you know what I'm saying? Like, on that level, you can take some pretty big artistic chances and not sing, I want to hold your hand anymore. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can start cranking out some sitar music and start singing about elephants and
octopus's garden. Isn't that wild, though, how they kind of created an alternate reality, though? Because didn't their, like, production company start that whole thing with the girls running and screaming and, like, they created, like,
I don't know if that's a history.
That's what I've heard, is that they started it as a mass hysteria thing. Like, they would, the record company would actually send all these girls out and have them scream and holler like this in front of the cameras. And so... when people started seeing the Beatles come into their town, they really started acting like that.
Started running out. Yeah, that makes sense.
Because nobody had acted like that before. I mean, Elvis and maybe Elvis and the Beatles, but that was about it. But they said they did it with Elvis too. Like, it was, you know, it was part of promoting them. They show these girls acting all crazy, and it got other girls doing it. And now, of course, that's kind of what girls do too. So. I mean, the girls I know.
Sexist. He thinks that the Beatles just show up and your wife's bra is just going to fly off.
Have you ever been to a concert with you know, late teenage or early 20s girls?
Not since I was a late teenage boy.
Yeah, but you did, though, right? And what those girls, late teenage, early 20s, they hollered and screamed?
No, they were like real sour because we were church kids and we were cynical about everything and we were not going to have a good time, damn it.
All right.
Or if you're grabbing the hardcore scene, they're in there in the pit with you.
Yeah.
I'm playing. I know how people are.
Well, you watch a pop music concert today from pop, from any time, really. I mean, it's how people act. Now, I was looking through some movies here, and we saw I saw a few things like Alice Through the Looking Glass, and that was a pretty interesting concept for me for an alternate universe. And you go back to the story that was, I've got some really neat, I think, I don't know if it's first edition, or but it's a really old version of Alice in Wonderland and Alice Through the Looking Glass upstairs. Super neat book, but it kind of starts, I don't know if you've seen the movie, it was always really creepy to me when I was a kid, and I was into it, where she's you know, looking into the mirror, and she kind of walks through it, and I think in the book she ends up fighting the Jabberwocky, which that actually doesn't happen until later in the series. It doesn't happen in the movie, in the book, Through the Looking Glass, but I always thought that was a really cool scene where she's fighting that, you know, dragon thing, and it's
Snickersnack.
A whole world on the other side of her mirror. And sometimes if you stare, well, at least I did when I was a kid, I haven't done it in a long time, but if you stare into a mirror for long enough, it can make you feel really weird and feel like there really is a big place behind you. And you know, when I was a kid, I would also
do some cult practices.
Tell me you didn't imagine looking through a mirror and traveling through it when you were a kid. I definitely did. And also would lay on my back on my bed and put my feet on the ceiling and pretend I was walking on the ceiling. And if you do that for long enough, it would seem like
the
ceiling really was the floor.
Yeah, and if you're Jim Carrey on Dumb and Dumber, you can get in the middle of it and go, it feels like you're running at an incredible rate of speed.
Yep. Well, I think it works because we all did that as kids, or at least I feel like we all did. Maybe it was just me. But I'd pretend I was walking around on the ceiling and pretend I was, you know, imagine what it would be like to go through the mirror. And doing hallucinogens, you know, especially if you would stare at yourself in the mirror, it really feels like a gateway to another reality, especially if you look yourself in the eyes in the mirror for a little while when you're doing that. So
the take 2,600 milligrams of Benadryl and try it. No, I'm just not going to do that. That is so stupid, people. Don't take Benadryl. Go find some crack. Butt crack, I mean. Get addicted to stiff butt crack.
Chank them.
Did you ever see that episode of well, that reminds me now, remember the episode of South Park where they start sniffing the cat's butts when they're peeing too? They travel to another reality because it's a spoof on heavy metal, you know, and
heavy metal.
So Kenny, you know, they're the cartoon
dude. That's crazy. I was at a antique store today, and they have the giant one, almost a poster, probably almost the size of this wall over. I'm exaggerating. Probably at least a fourth of the heavy metal chick with the sword and stuff.
Heavy metal.
Ashley goes, heavy metal. She goes, because she collects movie posters. She's like, I don't know if I want that particular one. What is that movie about? And as I start telling her, like literally 30 seconds into me going, blah, 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 and holy shit, that's the Fifth Element. It's almost exactly the same. And so I typed it in, and of course I wasn't the first one to realize that there's whole comparisons side by side. One of the only differences is the beginning where the two chicks,
what's up,
one
talk of them, they
find the artifact, and the other one, the girl, is the artifact. It's kind of the only twist to the Fifth Element. Okay. But yeah, it's basically a live action version of heavy metal with not as good music.
Good evening, Toxic Cube. Yes, Dalton. Yo, we're having Sierra Nevada. These are bottled in North Carolina, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah,
Mills River, North Carolina. Yeah. So there's a few, and there's a few Tennessee breweries around here. I mean, they pop up everywhere, but I mean, there's a few in the local area. But I tend to not find anything except for, like, they have a Dunkel and an IPA at most stores. If you go to the bars, you can get the beers, but mm-hmm. I'm not a Dunkel and IPA all the time kind of guy, man. I like to mix it up.
Which one of the local ones, they make like a jalapeno lager?
I don't know.
Crap, who makes that? Which one of them makes it around here? It's actually, when they do it, it's really good.
Jalapeno, I'm trying to think. I remember when they did it. Mm-hmm. Wasn't Johnson City Brewing Company?
No, Little Animals.
It was Johnson City Brewing Company.
Whenever you were taking them first steps out to your
you have not played their
independent music career, and it's like, I would go out and play with every once in a while.
Is Little Animals still open in Johnson City? Does anybody know?
I want to say it is. I don't know.
They make some good stuff, and it's like weird stuff that you wouldn't necessarily think would be good, and it's like, it's as strong as wine, so you buy this beer, and it's like $8-$10 for one bottle of beer, but it's, you know, 15-16% alcohol, something like that, and they have some that's even more expensive, but some of that stuff is pretty wild tasting. I like that stuff a lot, and it's like a I don't know, like, what'd you call it? Like, an after-dinner beer or something like that? Like
dessert
beer? Yeah, I don't know if I call it dessert necessarily, because it wasn't, the ones I had wasn't sweet or anything, but it was like, I don't know, it's not like I just, you'd drink a bunch of them and get drunk. You'd drink one bottle of it, and that'd be all you'd have. And
says you. I had a chocolate wine once that was sort of sneaky, because you didn't feel like if you eat a lot of chocolate really quickly, it kind of feels like your throat's burning anyway. Mm-hmm. So if you're drinking chocolate wine, you're just like, you don't notice that. It's like, oh, wait, this is stronger than I thought it was. So it's a sneaky, sweet wine.
I wonder if anybody's making any, like super hot pepper moonshine.
I don't know. What would you call it? Dragon's breath?
Fuck, I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I told Wilbur, if you're paying attention, man. Go get some of that distillate stuff that you're already using anyway and throw that in some of that liquor and make some Green Dragon. Really mess Tennesseans up.
Man, I ordered, back in the day, I ordered some authentic absinthe. This was about 2000, probably. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the internet was still in its infancy, but I went to a French website and ordered a bottle of absinthe. It cost me like $120. And I also paid another $120 for a silver and gold inlaid spoon to properly to do the absinthe with the right way. And my roommates got home and they had drank the whole bottle of it, and somebody had stolen my spoon before I ever saw the damn thing.
Dang!
Yeah, fucking dicks. My French teacher's son. From high school, he was. I think he's the one that did it. He was staying at my staying over with my roommates, and
well, I've had.
So I never got to actually try it.
I've had authentic absinthe. I will not
much on it. I don't know if you know. Well, did it completely right.
This was. Wasn't. Did you have the stuff from the gas station by chance? Because it's mostly liquor. The only reason they put the liquor store, not gas station, the liquor store, I would say, because
where it came from.
They take the way they do it here in the United States to make it legal is they drop the thuyum count almost down to nothing, and they overcompensate with a much, much higher liquor count. So by the time the thuyum actually starts kicking in,
well, you barely feel the one
more. Yeah.
So versus some people, I will not discuss their names, with a giant statute of limitations behind it, so I'm safe. They gave me like authentic stuff because there were some people that had to make it, and it is way closer to marijuana edibles than it is like liquor.
Yeah,
like it really is. It's more of a psychedelic.
The green fairy.
I got the brain flip, and that's what it reminded me of. Hmm. So, but it's not something that I enjoyed so much that I've thought to seek it out all these years later or anything. Yeah. But it definitely was completely different than the. I take that back. Yeah. No. I tried the liquor store kind, and I thought the liquor store kind was much just. Kind of like licorice alcohol to me, like almost like just drinking like green Sambuca. Yeah. I don't know if you've ever had that or not.
I've had the liquor store absinthe and it wasn't anything right home.
But, yeah.
But, you know, it was said it had a reputation, and I imagine back in the, you know, probably medieval France, that when they were making absinthia back then, it probably had a much higher wormwood content, and without any government regulating it, whoever's absinthe made you trip out the most was probably the one who was most popular.
So they're popular like writers, wasn't it? Like,
yeah, it was.
I think there's a very popular one, like Hawthorne or somebody that wrote
Hemingway, I think. But yeah, it was pretty popular around, you know, it was always popular in France, especially in the early, you know, turn of the 20th century France. It was real big around then. But do some of those customers love their chocolate wine, do they?
Good stuff. Maybe I'm an old lady at heart, Dalton.
I hadn't been drinking any lately, so instead of like when I go to the grocery store, I'd start to grab me a 6-pack of beer, and I'd say, oh, let's grab some wine, put it up. It was a fair one. I have some wine put up for, you know, guests and stuff like that. So I've been buying like top shelf grocery store wine. So it's not really top shelf wine, but you know, $20-$30 bottles of wine, good wine to put up. And never have bought any chocolate, but maybe I'll need to, because I'm trying to get something for everybody. You know, some Chardonnays, some Pinots, some Cabernets.
I don't do colored wines, like reds and darks. Definitely like a blueberry. Any of those like really dark wines, for some reason, it has to just be me, because I'm the only person that's ever had this happen. two or three glasses of a dark red wine or anything like that, I'm hungover worse than any liquor I've ever had. My head is pounding. I don't know if there's like something in the sulfides or in the color of the grapes or what.
Do you drink cheap wine?
I don't want to sound braggadocious here, but I drink extremely expensive wine, right, only because it's free.
Right.
But I've noticed anything that's cold. No. This is like the big box wines, man. One glass of that and I've got headaches.
Yeah.
But there's something inside dark, like red wines and stuff like that, that does not react well to my body. It gives me a pulsing, pounding headache.
Yeah, I've heard people say that. To me, I don't know. I really like it. I like pretty much any kind of wine that's not sweet. I like pretty much any dry wine.
You like dry ones,
Ben? Oh, yeah. Okay. I can't drink a sweet wine. I can't drink it.
I've learned that people are different. So I was very uncultured to wine up until the last couple of years. But I've noticed that there's I didn't know this, but certain wineries make non-sweet wines, and certain wineries make sweet wines, and some certain wineries do a mix of both, and there's different ways of doing it. And I always, up until I realized people buy it intentionally, just assumed that bitter wine meant it was cheap and shitty.
Yeah.
I thought the sweeter meant it was better. And the whole time I was just buying girly, like really girly wines, not realizing it was a $6 bottle of wine barefoot. This is better.
Barefoot and Pip Pick. Yeah. Moscato. Sure, I can't drink
it. Yeah, I don't like the bitter ones.
About as sweet as I can drink is like a, that's probably why if you're drinking like sweet red wines, that's probably why you're getting headaches.
That's bad.
I can't drink those either.
I like the sweet clear ones, or not clear ones, but I guess what you'd call white, yeah, or the pink colored rosé. I like that, but since you go like dark red, that apothic blood stuff that you guys drink, I might as well just drink like maple syrup.
That's a red blend. I got some apothic Chardonnay upstairs.
I think I was just comparing the thickness of that apothic. It's like drinking animal blood.
I like a Malbec.
I like Malbec too. Girl Dragon, familiar. Man. Whew. I found the...
Where have you been able to find that?
Girl Dragon?
Yeah.
No.
It was like I found it like those one times and I really, really liked their Malbec. And then it's like, I've not seen it in years.
According to Dalton, it happens to other people. Red wine contains what's called tannins, which is a headache trigger for a lot of people. Okay.
Oh, yeah. It's horrible.
Yeah, he's not the only one I've heard say that.
I can put back some like liquor and stuff like that. I mean, I just can. But you put red wine in front of me, two glasses, I mean, like, that's about as much as I can do, because I know the next day my head is just going to be splitting.
Yeah.
You splitting.
Splitting
like yourself. Like Hank Hill's vein.
So is that a good segue to split these realities?
Well, it could be. We could split between...
Also, I've always had this theory, because it seems like a lot of times, what if happens, you know, a lot of times if you dream, what if you're like tapping into like your parallel universe selves? Because I've had a lot of dreams that are very like mundane, and it's like it'd be like just us doing almost the same thing, but your house is set up completely different.
Yeah, so perhaps that's another, you know, parallel universe, and you're kind of joining minds with parallel golf.
Third joke. He goes, I'm going to screw this one up, so it's not verbatim. He goes, I like marijuana. It keeps me from dreaming. Man, I hate dreaming. That's some awful shit. Who wants to go to sleep and dream? I don't want to go to sleep at night and help my landlord fix his four-wheeler.
sometimes that's what happens. Like, I mean, I've done it before where I've been at a show that I clearly know I'm at the Hideaway, just say, but the Hideaway doesn't look like the Hideaway. It looks like a completely different place.
Yeah, I know that feeling.
Even in my brain, I can still remember walking to the exact same spot in downtown where it is, but it's just...
Well, it's funny that you mentioned the highway. All these weird things that, like, I'm starting to talk about, y'all just keep bringing up something related to it. And I was thinking of it, too, because I was thinking of the Hideaway. And I know it was the Hideaway. It was Heather's Hideaway at the time. Mm-hmm. Oh, but it was the same place.
Way back when.
But it was the same place.
Like 20 years ago.
Now. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Now I went to watch, I think I was watching Eviction there. Eviction. I can't remember. But it was during one of the Blue Plum Festivals in probably 2001. One of the first ones that they started doing. I don't know when. I think they brought them back in like 96. But this is where it was really starting getting big. And I was about 18, 19 at the time. And went to the Hideaway and was watching a show. And went into the bathroom. And I saw a guy that I knew in there, and he gave me some mushrooms in the bathroom. But the but the bathroom was like, in my memory, the bathroom was bigger. And wide, you know, the hideaway is a tiny bathroom with like a urinal and a stall and a sink, and that's it. But in this memory of me, and I know I was in the hideaway. it was a big old long, you know, string of urinals. And so that's always struck me as odd, is why do I see a big, you know.
I've dreamed several times that I've bought the hideaway.
Really?
I've literally dreamed. I don't want to give my plans away, but if dreams come true, I'm going to own the hideaway by the time I'm like 60 for some reason. That's mundane. I'd buy it if it went up for sale and I had money. I don't have the money right now to do that, but I would save it. Hey, Tarvo, if you listen, sell it to me, buddy. I don't think Tarvo owns it, does he?
He just runs it. I think a lady runs it.
So, yeah.
Might be Heather.
I remember the original owner. I knew the owner pre-whoever took over afterwards, because he sold it just to get out from under it.
Remember Tina's Pub?
I know the name. I remember the name.
Maybe that's where I was thinking of. Maybe it wasn't the Hideaway. Maybe it was the Tina Pub. Because I can't remember.
Irisons too.
Because I can't remember if it had urinals all the way down or anything.
Irisons was. It's like you could fit 14 people in that little building, but it was always a blast.
72 official. Like, yeah, because it went like this way because it had that side room and stuff. Like, but if the official capacity was actually 72, which is mega tiny for.
God, that's wild. It was so.
I fell off of it.
Yeah.
But I recovered. I completely and accidentally did a front flip. I just totally was like, oh shit, I got back up on stage. Yeah. There wasn't a whole lot of people there to see it, but like, I just wasn't expecting it because up until that point, I'd played like the Hideaway, some churches, and I think the biggest one was maybe like the Fire Escape was like, but like, damn, Irisons was like, you break your damn leg falling off that stage. It's like, it was like 8 feet tall.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, go ahead, sorry.
No, sorry, I was just going to say, it was a very interesting little tiny venue.
I liked Irisons. I always had a good time there.
Because, you know, even if something happened, you had a crap show and you had 20 people in it, it looked freaking packed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that's one thing about those intimate shows, you know. Yeah, it's you call it an intimate room, but if you catch a small performance from a, like I caught, I accidentally caught Three Doors Down in like 2001. I'm not a fan of Three Doors Down. I wasn't then, but I caught them in a small room performance in front of like 200 people, and it was actually really cool. They did, you know, a good show, and like I never would have thought. I just accidentally ended up watching them because I was waiting to watch a hockey game. I wasn't even 21 at the time.
And they won you over, and you've been a huge fan ever since. And you went, if I could be like that one, you want that played at your funeral?
If I go crazy, then will you still call me? No, I was in Tampa, and I was wanting to watch a hockey game, and I was hanging out. I didn't know really where anything was in Tampa, so I was hanging out. Right around the stadium, and I went into this bar for lunch, and it was just like a restaurant, but like after like 4 o'clock they started IDing people coming in and stuff, and I was already in there, so they were serving me beer and they didn't ever check my ID or anything, but Three Doors Down started playing at like 6 o'clock that night, and so I just kind of sat in there and hung out waiting on the hockey game, and then they started playing. It was really cool.
What's up, Alvin?
Good to see you in the chat, brother. According to Dalton, once tannins are ingested, they spur the release of serotonin, a neurotransmitter that can cause headaches in some people. Thank you very much for that.
Serotonin's the awareness. People say it's happy, but it's not. It's aware. It's the opposite of melatonin. It's also your psychedelics are serotonergic. So.
Your dopamine and your oxytocin are those things that make you feel good.
Yeah. Well, anandamide's in there, too, but it's a very... missed one because it's with a kiss and release. Marijuana actually is the one that hijacks the anandamide function.
Oh, is that right?
It's supposed to be the center of just well-being. And anandamide, which you can get by eating large amounts of chocolate, comes down and hits your CB1 and 2, goes boop, oh, you feel okay. Just zero. And then weed comes in, and if you've ever looked at neurotransmitters, they look literally like just like shapes. So if you want to talk about alternate realities and how they're possible, you can boil all your neurotransmitters down to Tetris. Whether or not whether or not a corkscrew fits into this or not is whether or not you can get high off of it.
So it's like a thickness.
Yeah. Well, I'm upset on some of them. But anyway, so here comes your weed, THC, and instead of just going, oops, here's a little kiss, you're zero, it goes, let's be zero for 4 hours, and just stays there. So that's why it's so much stronger.
Hmm.
Yeah. Don't do drugs. Unless you need them, kids.
So like a THC duck penis touch you.
I don't like comparing THC to duck penis. Because I'm getting this like weird thought in my head of like, because as soon as you said THC,
I don't want to smoke weed no more, man. It's making me feel weird about it.
Of like the goose, the eternal goose god that we're always praying to have gassed. Yeah. Yes, we are secretly a cult that's trying to put that damn goose god under the ground forever. He's one of the ancient gods of Appalachia, and we will smite the demon beast.
And we'll give you free cigarettes for joining us.
It's all part of the plan. We're going to smoke that son of a bitch out using those cigarettes. It's all going to come together. Watch. Whoa! Like puzzle pieces. I forget what I was talking about. The goose. When you said THC goose demon dick thing, I pictured a giant goose, demon goose, but it's got like elegant marijuana wings, like made of like, I've never actually seen a pot plant like in person. It's always been thought on a TV screen. But like big marijuana leaf plant duck thing, big bud for big. We can move on to the next part now.
Okay, you just made a Stoner Doom album.
Yep.
Well, I just ordered the OK Doomer pedal, so we can make it.
Okay. Demon Duck.
We can make...
You have no idea how happy that made me. That is the most arbitrary, stupid event to happen in somebody's life, maybe. But I'm so happy. It's been my white whale.
Well, I'm glad you got it.
We can make the Bud Goose album.
Yeah, you just created a Pokemon.
It's called Smoke the Goose or Gas the Goose. And it's like,
I like Smoke the Goose too.
Breathing toxic weed smoke out. The whole album could be this out. Like when people ask us what our intentions are, I'd be like, we're trying to give marijuana a bad name.
Yeah, we feel like it's had too much good press since Woody Harrelson put out that grass documentary.
Yeah.
It's been all uphill. We got to put marijuana back in its place.
We got to knock this son of a gun down a few pegs.
That's right.
It's kind of like that one thing I remember saying. It's like someone's like, I recently moved into a neighborhood, but and every like 3 or 4 months, I noticed my neighbor goes out into his backyard and fires a gun off into the ground several times. He's like, hey, it keeps the property value down. Because you see people running around the neighborhood, you know, jogging, the property value's going up too high.
That's a good point. Pit bulls and stuff. Don't do that. It's cool.
Well, this concept of the back room
stage with the red curtains, you see it?
Uh-huh.
That's how you get on the stage. That's mm-hmm. what this whole thing was.
Well, and the thing is that it's in the back room, though, was endless. There was mm-hmm. never any, until you were timed to come on stage, you could wander around forever and you'd never actually come out into the main universe. And in the story, Dale Cooper, the protagonist, he wanders around the back rooms for 25 years. But there's a concept of back rooms has become popular over the last few years. During COVID, people really got into it, and they would go into these places they would call liminal spaces. Have you heard of liminal spaces?
Yep.
Yes.
So this website, usmobile.com/blog, the backrooms, whoever's blog this is, says liminal spaces can be a physical location or a state of mind that sparks feelings of transition, nostalgia, and mystery, a threshold between here and there. Liminal spaces have been an object of fascination for some time and attained a massive spike in popularity following the spring of 2020. Now at 500,000 members, the subreddit r liminal space mm-hmm. is in the top 1,500 Reddit communities. And it's a lot of streets, office buildings, shopping centers emptied out, and they show these places with no people in it. And maybe there is his flat. Maybe this one. You know, have you ever seen that flat earth proof? They're like, oh, you can't see the end of the hallway. It's vanishing point. So that's why you can't see. That's why there's perspective.
Sounds solid to me.
Dude, I have never seen a hallway that I could not see the end of. I've seen some long fucking hallways. I've never seen a hallway I couldn't see the end of. Have you ever seen a hallway you couldn't see the end of?
No, I want to see.
Not even in those dreams where you're running and the hallway keeps stretching. You can still see the end of it. Yeah. It's just it keeps going and going and going like that bunny rabbit.
You know, like one of the earliest beginnings to the liminal spaces, fear has its roots in Mario 64.
You were telling me that, and I didn't understand it.
There's a funny one in there.
Check the chat. Mario 64, if you go back and play it, like I noticed as a kid, I just thought I was crazy. I didn't think anybody else felt this way, but the internet apparently agrees with me that Mario 64 is kind of creepy. Like because you're running around, all the other Mario games, there's enemies everywhere. You got to run fast. Mm-hmm. There's danger and stuff. But Mario 64, unless you jump into the painting, there's nothing else. Even the little Koopa guys disappear into the wall until you get like a foot away from them and stuff. So the whole game, you're by yourself. And it really, even as a kid, like you're sitting in your room late at night and the cast of music is going, and you just hear the footsteps are echo real dark, and you hear Mario yelling. There's nobody. You can run out of this giant castle, the courtyard, there's nobody. Every now and then you'll see a little mushroom head pop out of the wall.
You're talking about the level select area.
Yeah, just in the middle of the main hub area. It's giant. And it turned out a lot of people also thought that was creepy because it's like, if you got lost in here, you know, there's nothing. You'd just be lost in here forever by yourself. And I think that's what creeps people out about liminal spaces, is not like the actual death. It's what would happen if you just got trapped in here and you're just trapped in here by yourself
forever. At least I have my glasses.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, there you go. Exactly the same thing.
No! Oh.
But the backrooms thing you're talking about is primarily just a lot of... made for entertainment that people made on the idea that if you could, like, what is it, when you ping out of reality, like, like they thought of, like, if you could do that in reality, what would be there? And then people started using these images that people were posting on forums to create a hypothetical backrooms to our reality.
Dalton thinks you just created a Pokemon, a grass psychic type, with it's a marijuana Pokemon.
Okay, we'll get a custom deck together with, we'll get Goffymon on there, too.
And Alvin's talking about...
He's the trainer.
Microbiome. Biology and Elizabeth, and that's right. That's how we do. We're jack of all trades here, master of none. But the
yeah, there's more to that saying.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, tell us.
Mm-hmm. It's like, what was it? I just blanked out on it.
No.
A jack of all trades.
Jack of all trades, master of none.
Is better than a master of one. It's basically saying it's actually better to be well-rounded and actually know, have skills in a lot of things instead of throwing all your cards in like one deck.
But at the same time, you end up with, you know, I don't know if you're the, you ever seen the Dunning-Kruger effect thing, where it's like your confidence, your area of expertise with the Dunning-Kruger effect can lead you to believe that you are more competent in other areas than you actually are. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what the idea is between the effect is that, you know, a person of high intelligence is actually, what is it that you're proportionate to? Okay, I've lost the way to
Michael Jackson wasn't a good baseball player, but he was quite possibly the best basketball player of all time, and quite possibly one of the worst pro league baseball players of all time.
So because you're
Michael
real...
Michael Jordan.
Yeah. So I was like,
this is the Mandela effect. I come from a world where Michael Jackson is the best athlete of all time. Michael Jordan goes, woo!
I was very confused for a moment. Like,
okay, yeah, Michael Jordan was the GOAT at basketball, basically, but he was considered pretty much a laughable minor league baseball player when he tried that for a minute. Yeah,
he played in the majors because he was Michael Jordan.
But I guess, man, don't you notice that a lot of people that use this Dunning-Kruger effect seem to suffer from it, though?
It says it's a cognitive basis. I needed a simple way to pull this up. It's a cognitive basis in which people overestimate, they have limited competence in a particular domain, overestimate their abilities. High performers tend to underestimate their skills. Low performers tend to overestimate their skills.
It's called, you're just dumb enough to not know that you're that dumb.
That's a good way of putting it,
but you're dumb enough to not realize how dumb you are, and I think that's a dangerous place to be in.
Yep. Back to the back rooms, though, on liminal spaces. So, Seekers of Liminal Spaces, according to this blog here. Let's find out who made this blog. I want to give them credit because it's pretty interesting. If it actually tells his name. I don't think it does. So I don't know who makes this blog, but... Anthony Klinko. There we go.
Klinko.
Anthony Klinko.
Klinko. Klinko's better.
Let's check out Anthony Klinko. He's an author.
Let's check out if he's a POS. And if he
he's from Philadelphia. His last article was about which carrier has the best cell phone coverage.
That's a little boring. Anthony, you're doing God's work, I guess.
Yeah, he's doing a lot of tech stuff, looks like here.
Is this like his said, stuff?
Philadelphia. Yeah. I saw like a little thing about days. The Kennesburg district, whatever that is. And there it's like the drug capital of the country.
Vaporwave, a microgenre of music characterized by sampling smooth jazz, R&B,
sorry,
and elevator music from the 1980s. Why is he talking about vaporwave?
Terms to know, to understand.
Oh, is this the liminal space thing?
Yeah, the back rooms.
Oh, that makes a lot of sense now.
So, we're going to go to back to the back rooms, and it's the back rooms tale, like a horrific evil twin to the uneasy yet satisfyingly consistent world of liminal spaces, taking its basic qualities and upping the ante to an inescapable corporate maze from hell. It's a different type of experience, what the pandemic also induced. Feelings of doom, panic, and isolation. With the back rooms, it is less about the space depicted and more about the fear and mystery of what exists out of sight.
Have you seen the fan-made videos?
I don't know if
they're worth watching. If you
what want. About, you know, if I actually, you know, when you're in like a place that's normally busy, when it's not and it's abandoned like that, and you're gonna, it's like, I've always kind of enjoyed it.
Yeah. I think you're immune to it though, because you've worked in retail like me, where it was totally normal for me to be in a grocery store and there'd just be nobody else there.
Well, but, you know, I like too. If you're in like a, like, back just in the do day, it, or, you're in like your school YouTube. Or something, and you're like,
they've made some real good ones actually.
The only person in there, just, it's, I don't know, it's nice. Or well, you've been into like a shutdown like mall or something, and you're like, no one's in there. And it's peaceful. It's very.
I've worked in retail before, so I've been in those situations plenty, like overnight working where there's not a lot of people around. Mm-hmm. And I went and had a couple of nice experiences. One, when their Kmart was open in Johnson City, they had, if you went all the way to the back or to the left side of it, and there was like a little shelf, and you could just kind of walk around behind it. And there was all the section of the old Kmart back there, where they had like the concession stands. Mm-hmm. And when I was a kid, you know, that was one of my, you know, I never got to go in or anything like that. So I remember going into Kmart and seeing all those drinks. You know, I don't know what the hell they were called. Those, I guess they were just fucking Kool-Aid. But they went, you know, you could see it swirling around inside the machine there.
It's like all the slushies.
Yeah.
You know, if you went to Walmart, they had the ICs.
Mm-hmm. And I went back into there, and there was nobody around there. There was just like, it was totally wide open. And I just walked around. I walked around, I bet, for 30 minutes in there in the back room of Kmart. Mm-hmm. And it was like I was in a different place. It was like it was taking me back in time to a totally different dimension. Let's look at this entry 67.
I would do just back rooms fan made. I wouldn't put entities on there because
okay.
The ones where the entities aren't shown are a little bit better.
Okay.
You know, fans don't really have money.
Level list.
I have no idea. I've not seen any of
these. These are all too long.
A lot of them you can just recognize because it looks. Do that one. That looks pretty good. So it looks like an actual back room. And I got that vaporwave tune stuck in my head. People keep even more. Just go to YouTube and type in back rooms.
Okay.
Because it's such a generic sort of. Set where the back rooms can just literally be liminal spaces. The people have made a lot of pretty convincing movies, I guess. People are into jump scares, so yeah. See, they're all pretty easy to make. I have three funniest back rooms out of that. There you go. What is the back room? So there.
Let's just see. We got no audio on this or what?
I don't know. Doesn't look like it.
Well, let's see if we can find something else. Due to the fact that there is infinite amount of levels. You ever play those, You ever play those like dungeon crawler video games where it has like a random generated levels, you know, where you go like through
procedurally generated stuff?
Yeah, so that kind of would make you think of what something like the backrooms might be. It's like nobody actually created. It's just constantly randomly putting levels together where you travel through these things, and they say you can never get out of them. There, this is a good one. Backrooms. In 1905, the government's created a story agency called B-Link and Laboratories and started kidnapping people to test their subjects. Only one person survived and was able to tell the scientists that he saw weird creatures and monsters in the rooms. All of his friends were considered dead, and he was afraid, or the government was afraid of what they discovered. They closed the gates and never let anybody back in again. And the lab has been closed down, or has it? You know, it's kind of the funny thing, like the, you know, it's like they admit, you know, all those things that they never admitted that the CIA and all these other government agencies did in like the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, like the MK Ultra, Monarch, all these different programs. They're like, oh yeah, those things actually did exist. They stopped in the 60s. Nobody ever got in trouble for it. Nobody was ever fired. There was never any reform of the agency.
But we totally don't do anything.
Yeah, we don't do that anymore.
All those rumors you're hearing today, those aren't true.
Well, I think Anthony Cinco here has given us one of the best overviews of the back room. He says that it started really picking up between 2021 and 2022, and he shows the the rise in the Google search data right there over from 2019 on. It started really picking up, and now it's at its most popular ever. And if we go on down to his article, he says, seekers of the liminal spaces may scour their local communities or comb the internet for material, but how exactly does one fall upon the backrooms? Well, within the context of the lore, the infamous 4chan post that started it all reads, if you're not careful and you no clip out of reality in the wrong areas, you'll end up in the backrooms where it's nothing but the stink of old moist carpet, the madness of mono yellow, the endless background noise of fluorescent lights at maximum hum buzz, and approximately 600 million square miles of randomly segmented, even empty rooms to be trapped in. God save you if you hear something wandering around nearby, because it sure as hell has heard you.
So that's where people in the missing 411 fan are clipping out of reality and falling in there. That's a theory.
Yeah. Well, actually, missing 411 was one of the things I wanted to bring up, because, you know, that we talked about stairways in the woods, and we talked about missing 411, the people, these, you know.
Going way back in our discography.
Yeah, Staircases in the Wood was like
you want to,
episode two or three, yeah. Our episodography. But this, let's read Anthony says here. He says, I slipped into the back rooms not by no clipping out of reality, but by being served a TikTok showing mysterious Google Maps content at remote coordinates. I'm a sucker for low rent conspiracy theories and Google Map finds, so it's no surprise the algorithm performed this match made in heaven. I, along with others, was served backrooms related content across social platforms, created an awareness that eventually became a deeper curiosity. And so basically it's like turned into this thing where it's like a role-playing game almost, where people try to create their, you know, backrooms content and entities, and basically are making a game out of it. But, you know, it comes from that sense of dread, of longing, of loss, of lostness. And it would, you know, be something like being stuck in a room like this, and every time you pulled the curtain open to go into another room, you just went into another hallway exactly like this, and it was endless, and you could never get out of it. And that's kind of the idea behind the back rooms. Unless it's time for you to go out of the back room, in which, you know, some sort of portal is open, which puts you back in the real world. But, you know, is that all movie stuff? Is it dreams? You ever read any Carlos Castaneda? And he's traveling to these different spaces via dreams and psychedelics. And
they say where stuff's endless until they want you to go. That's almost like if you go into like Appalachian lore and like lore of throughout history, like things with like fae, whenever the little fairies and stuff fuck with you, and they'll make like the forest keep repeating itself.
Yeah.
You can get lost.
You live in I believe you do live in a liminal space in there, Alvin. Better than somebody and being an expert, somebody who knows more and more and less about less and less until he knows everything about nothing. That's a good way to put that, Alvin. Better be a jack of all trades, master of none, than an expert who's only good for one thing.
I want that big goose god behind us. Alvin, or not Alvin,
Bo knows everything, and Esther didn't kill himself. Oh, he can.
Wilbur needs to make us a marijuana goose god poster.
Well, to finish it up tonight, let's
that duck should be toxic.
To finish it up tonight, I want to go to this is from the Archives of Appalachia collection from East Tennessee State University. They've got some photographs from our area back from 1856 to 1940, and this is a part of the Kelly and Green Company negatives from 1856 to 1840, or to 1940. So we're going to look at a few of these things. We're going to take a trip to an alternate universe. This is the H.P. King Company, the 50th anniversary. This is in, it says it's unknown, but we look right here, it's the 50th anniversary, 1889 to 1933. It must be 1939, like but it looks like 1933. It must be, I mean, 50th anniversary. It was founded, I thought it was founded in 1899, but I guess H.P. King was founded in 1889. And that must be a 9 right there. But that's their 50th Golden Jubilee, the H.P. King Company. And that really is another time where you had locally owned department stores. You know, pretty much everything. Every department store now is pretty much a chain except for, like, your big retailers and, like, you know, what
maybe
you call
it. Go back to that.
Well, I would think that would be
interesting,
great.
Interesting, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
A piece of news that is important. I've been saying it for a minute. I think other people have been saying it. But it's official because now the experts have weighed in as of maybe a week or two ago.
Yeah.
Review bra. You know, review bra, real skinny dude wears a suit and he goes around testing fast food. I know you've seen it on memes.
I probably have, but I don't know Ralph, who that is.
If you look up review bra, he does fast food stuff and he's real articulate. He has pretty much said his job has become very, very difficult and almost unbearable because the quality of fast food, as he is a food critic, that's what he does on YouTube, yeah. He tries food. Says it's gotten so disgusting he almost can't even do his job anymore. Right. I've been saying that for a good
minute. Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Like, it's not even fixed correctly anymore. It's not even that they've made the ingredients bad. Like, the McDonald's potatoes have been poopy for a minute. Now they didn't cook them. Now they're all soggy and not done and stuff. So, I agree with your review, brah. The experts have spoken. Fast food is dead.
Yeah, I haven't eaten McDonald's since 2015.
Sometimes when it's 3 a.m. and it's the only thing open and your stomach's saying, I'm going to make you vomit if you don't eat, you got to eat either McDonald's or beef jerky or whatever.
Beef jerky.
I'll take the beef jerky if the McDonald's ain't there. Mm-hmm. But, man, I went and got some Jack Links the other day. And it was just a bag of beef jerky hanging off the thing. And it said, beef jerky bacon. And I went, okay, well, I'll try something different. I'll take some jerkied bacon, right? Buy it, get it in the car, open it up, going down the road. It's just cold bacon in a bag. That's right. I was like, well, I've done this myself, but I didn't want to pay $12 for cold bacon in a bag.
Well, it's like when you can go to the meat section and buy the pre-cooked, microwavable pre-cooked bacon for like $4.
I
don't
have a microwave, unfortunately. I could throw it in my car and heat it up under, like, the manifold.
It's actually pretty good just when you crack the little thing open and heat it. It's about the same thing.
Okay, well, this was
about like just a lot cheaper.
Cold bacon. It just wasn't very pleasant.
It's good.
I ate it anyway because I was really hungry.
I was actually surprised at how good that pre-cooked bacon stuff is. And I never bought it for the longest time because it's like $4 for like 2.5 ounces or something like that. But when you open it up for your $4, it's like 12, 13 strips of bacon. It's like what you would normally get in a pack of bacon. So it's just has everything cooked out of it, so it's lightweight.
It's instant.
Yeah.
So anyway, since
I never heated it up.
So you can have your, instead of your 3 a.m. shredded cheese run, you can have a 3 a.m. bacon binge.
So I'm just theorizing, since all fast food is officially dead, maybe some of these mom-and-pop stores will get some more business.
That'd be awesome, because they actually make food.
Well, this is not a mom-and-pop store. This is a JCPenney, but look at this. Look how seriously they took themselves back in 1940.
The ugly-ass ceilings.
30th anniversary, 38th anniversary.
What is that?
You know, I wonder why they celebrated 38. That's like
a Masonic thing?
I don't know.
We are 138.
Right. People usually sort of celebrate 25, 50.
You know, that
30.
Exact store, if you fast forward in time and go all the way to the future, that whole case is full of, like, knives and dream catchers.
You think?
Knives and
one little section of it is Game Boy games.
Let's look at State Street in Bristol in 1898.
Muddy streets.
Muddy
again.
Streets.
What?
Railways.
What year?
1898.
Look at the buildings. The buildings are made of brick and stuff. I just don't understand.
Well, they paved it shortly after that.
Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Look what we got here.
Got real.
A little bit of grass.
Oh, all grass. Right.
Remember we did grass busters.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Because he said there was no mud. He was all mud, yeah.
Where's this at? Is this near the burger bar?
This is State Street. Yeah, this is that's like all the way at the end.
Right now.
The sign, Bristol, Tennessee, it's a good place to live, would be up there, wouldn't it?
I thought it would be right here. Like,
oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, you're right.
Okay, well, no, I'm not right either then. But, yeah, I see now.
Okay, west of State Street. From the crossing at Union Station, the old hotel at the left, the Nichols House, where the famous Greta Green of the Parson Burroughs, I don't know, never heard of that.
There's a bank right there where that plot is now.
Where over 1,000 couples were married.
And to the left of that is, what is it?
Shelby Street.
But you know, there's a, if you go to H.P. King, the store we looked at a minute ago, I don't think they're not in business anymore, but you still got, you got King College, you got LC King, you got William King Clothiers. The King name is still really big over there in Bristol.
Viking.
This is King Printing Company. Photocopy.
It's the King Center in downtown Johnson City.
Yep. Oh yeah, I wonder if that was the same thing. It is still it's still called the King Center.
Yeah. It's the one that has Main Street
Pizza. Main Street Pizza and then apartments King on top of it.
Export.
Oh, what did I do with my...
There are people. There King's Port.
Like King's Port.
No, I don't know. I said that name. As dumb as that sounds, like, I never even considered a lot of the stuff around here had a name for a reason. Like, and he was like, Powder Branch Road. And I was like, all right, actually, I'm learning something. Yeah. Never considered that. Makes me think, does that mean Valley Forge is where the forge was?
Yeah, yeah. Dude, I was going to do a show about that, but I could not find the information enough to do it. But there is a forge, and I found a Carter County history book from, like, the early 1900s. It talks all about the Valley Forge, tells where it is, and tells where the old fort was. They haven't been able to find the old fort. They don't know exactly where it is, but it's got some interesting stuff on that. And so this guy, at least back when he wrote this book, everybody knew where the fort was.
Right.
And he was able to say, oh, well, it's just 3 miles north of such and such. It was 3 miles west of Elizabethan, and it's up here. And the Valley Forge is actually just right down here. It's still there. The forge is there. Somebody shared Facebook photos on Facebook not long ago.
I don't remember who.
Well, when I saw that and looked it up, I started seeing, I started finding out more about it. And
it's Coal Chute Road. I had coal on it, right? Holy shit, does that mean there's stones up Stony Creek?
did you ever hang out in downtown Elizabethan when you were a teenager? Like
a little, not, well, I was a young adult when I was
there,
like
was
18, yeah.
When I was like 12, 13 years old, I would go down there and we would, me and my friends would, and look here, this is downtown Bristol again. Pretty awesome there. I'm not sure when that is exactly.
Tretter is actually a Carl's Jr. now. No, I'm Carl's Jr. I don't know where that joke came from.
But I used to go down to the downtown area.
Yeah, I was going
to
say Bass Pro, but then I got tongue tied and I wanted to say, that other one that I can't think of the name of.
And I'm going to see if I can find a picture of this place. But there was this old man. His name was the East Step Coal Company.
And yeah, the one that's right there at the very end of the, well, the other end of downtown as you're going into more of Elizabeth.
Yeah. And there was an old man that would sit there. And here it is. Here's the...
That little old house. Is that still there?
It's still there, but it's painted over. Oh, come on, Pinterest.
Once you suck a big old...
I don't want to be a Pinterest member. But this is... I would go down there to this East Step Coal Company. No, but I would sit there and I would talk to this old man and he'd tell me all about coal. And I don't remember any of it.
There used to be like a big pile of coal behind the...
Yeah, there was.
I remember that from when I was little.
Yeah, there was always coal out there, and people would come and still... There was a few people who would still come and get their coal from him. But he was like probably 80, 90 years old when I would go down there and talk to him. And this was, mid-1990s. There weren't many people using coal.
He actually used it at Hunter Elementary. Do you remember the clinker pile?
Yep.
They had a big pile of... rocks out back next to the basketball court, so on the other side of the fence. We thought those like space stones or something. It's like, wow, what is this? And it's just rocks that look like almost like acorns and all these weird shapes. And it was just what they called a clinker, is when like the coal would burn down to a point where it couldn't go down.
Burn up coal.
Just a rock basically, and we'd throw them at each other because they'd like make weird they hurt, but so it's out there throwing clinkers.
Yeah, that's pretty wild, Tim. You think about it, we went to a school that had, no air conditioning and had coal heat. I mean, how old are we?
We're not seniors. That's just how low funded Carter County was.
Dude, when we went, we were trying to figure out because, you know, they start school back so much earlier now, like start school at like 2nd, 3rd of August, mm-hmm. you know, first week of August, they start school. And I was like, man, why? Like, we didn't start school till like first week of September.
I know.
It's like, well, it's probably because we didn't have air conditioning. Like, I remember...
I tried to push it back in August, and they ended up having let us out too early because it
was hot. Yeah, we got hot, yeah. And we didn't have air conditioning. And you're right, our school heat was coal-powered.
Coal-powered, and when it got hot, they would open the windows and put big box fans everywhere.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep, and we walked... And we liked it. And I actually did walk both ways in the snow. When I went to Elizabethan schools, I lived on Arnie Hill, and I would ride my bike pretty much every day to school.
And the tires would catch on fire.
those were good old times, man. And it does feel like an alternate universe where, you know, you could be, you know, a 12-13-year-old kid with your buddies, 12-13-year-old, and you're riding around downtown all day, and you go rent a wrestling videotape. You go rent last year's WrestleMania from R&M Electronics and Video Rental Company, and then y'all ride your bikes over to your buddy's house and you watch this WrestleMania video that, you know, none of you's ever saw. Everybody wanted to watch it last year, but nobody's mom and dad were buying pay-per-view, but now you can rent it for $4 at R&M. And
because even back then pay-per-views were like $20-$30.
Yeah,
you're like, what?
Yeah, I never got to watch any of them, but there was one time we got lucky. And
I think I was an adult before I saw a pay-per-view.
Oh, yeah.
Or something.
First pay-per-view anything I saw was my uncle's rented one of the very first UFCs.
I think
one of the earlier ones of that. Yeah, it was one of the ones
I saw. The very first one was the one where Tank Abbott fought the kickboxer as the very finale one. And the round lasted 30 minutes, and that's when they finally decided that maybe we got to break this thing up into rounds instead of just letting them go at it, because it was like at the end of it, they're just laying there so tired neither one of them can move.
The first one that I saw, or the first one that I remember care about seeing, was when... Hulk Hogan fought Bill Goldberg. It was a pay-per-view. And no, I saw him before that. Never mind. Because I was watching the pay-per-view. I didn't see this part, but we were watching the pay-per-view at my friend's house where fucking Owen Hart died, where he fell out of the rafters.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I didn't see that part.
Let go.
Yeah, I didn't see that part, but we were watching that pay-per-view when that happened. So that's probably the first that I cared about anyway in pay-per-view. Now, look here, we got Bristol parading, you know. This is all the people you'd get for a parade today.
Yeah, you can actually even see Antifa back here. It'd be so funny.
The Proud Boys and Antifa.
They're like also, it's just the 50s or whatever. They're all well-behaved and marching.
Well, I remember there was anti-fascist. Look, all this king.
That's what, the 30s?
Yeah, they did form in Germany originally as a communist opposition to Hitler's National Socialist Party. So they basically figured Hitler didn't go far enough in seizing people's property that they wanted the government to take everything.
There's a Crest building in Johnson City as well.
I'm not even sure what Crest is. Yeah, it's over. It's down near.
It's right on the Hideaway.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not sure what Chris is.
Me neither.
We got drugs. We got jewelers. Look at this.
They sold foreskins.
Is it Foreman's? What is this? Something magical company?
Optical.
Seattle. Optical company, yeah.
It's a pair of glasses, too.
Yeah, I see. Optical. I buy cord optical company. I don't know. We got Bristol Floral Company. We got EW King. We got HP King. We got Kings Abound. Is this people looking out the window? It is. Mm-hmm. Neato.
Look at the sexy, weird, upside-down flower pot hat on that one. I never did understand those hats. Look at these hats down here. Like, all the women look like they're wearing those little leather football caps that football players wear.
Yeah, almost everybody wore hats in those days. You went out of the house, you were just about wearing a hat.
I think we should go back to the hat days.
I think we should definitely go back to, like, I don't know. You have a nice suit of clothes that you wear most of the time, and then you don't have to wear clothes. You don't have to have a whole wardrobe of stuff. People don't expect you to see
that. I agree. I've always thought that we should adopt, like, cartoon character rules. If I could wear the exact same outfit every single day, well, that'd give me a problem.
You know, that's
really
pretty much what people used to do.
Very too far from that, actually.
I would like to have about 5 or 6 different looks, and then when that goes away, I just kind of like an RPG. Oh, my broadsword broke. You go get another one. Yeah. It might not look exactly the same, but it's okay.
Yeah, that's pretty much what people do. You had like a suit of clothes that you wear to church. You had like your everyday clothes, and then you had like your night clothes, and you know.
Oh,
work,
know.
And then work clothes.
Another liminal thing that kind of freaks
work,
me out.
I wear legitimately like the same thing every day. I have like
the Borat freaky. No, the way. So that's Bruno. I was gonna say the Bruno freaky Vito. God, walk around.
We got a lot of parade photos here, trying to find something other than
the show Ed and Eddie,
mm-hmm.
and the show Steven Universe. I find both creepy. Because it's just children wandering around with no parents all the time. Like,
well, that was
empty, the neighborhood's empty, Ned, Ed, Nettie. Mm-hmm. Like, there's nobody, there's no adults except for Steven's dad in the whole show. The whole show is just weird.
Well, it was allegedly one of the things that they, when they were putting off, they started it in like the 80s or the late 70s. No. The Brady Bunch was one of the last ones where they had basically where the parents knew what they were doing. And according to, I can't remember her name, the girl who played Cindy Brady, Susan Olsen, I think is her name. According to her, basically that's the company that made the Brady Bunch had to fight tooth and nail to make the parents not be fucking morons. Like the back then, even the studio were already coming out. They want the kids to be in charge. They want the parents to be morons. And if you tried to make a dad that knows what he's talking about on the show, and that's not just like the butt of all the jokes on the show, now you can't do it. But apparently that was starting all the way back then, with the Brady Bunch. And they were trying to basically, according to Susan Olsen, she thinks they were trying to basically destroy the family by, you know,
don't watch TV.
Yeah,
or at least don't let your kids watch it.
Yeah, it's
just
bad.
Just passing the trauma on.
Yep.
I actually kind of believe that. I'm just trying to be a jerk about it because people are very connected to their TVs and stuff.
No, I think they're. I think they're. Oh, I do too. It's really what's put us in a lot of places that we are. Here we go.
That sign looks exactly the
this same. This is undated, so we don't know.
Look at them cars, though. That's be pretty fucking.
It looks like the 50s.
Yeah. Sign
late
looks
40s,
the same.
50s.
Yeah.
For the people not from here, that sign looks exactly the same to this day.
It's Eastman Kodak. Union Trust Company. Let's see what else we got.
Hey, dear AI, make me. That's how that works, right? You just talk to it. Dear AI.
that was some Bristol. Let's see what else we got here.
AI art is finally being used for what I think it should be used for, though. Like with a picture of Taylor Swift at the ice cream cones, where she's not letting the African kids have any.
That was funny. Yeah, I saw that.
Just stupid stuff that's just funny.
What was the one I just saw the other day that was like, I can't remember. Oh, man. I can't remember. It was a Taylor Swift one, and I'm not even going to say what it was because it just sounds really crude if I say it without remembering exactly. I'm trying to find something other than Bristol. This is August 1937.
I want to hear people cover songs, but like not actually make the band take the time to do it. Like I would like to hear Tom Waits cover a very specific The Bunny the Bear song because I think he would do it incredibly well. As dumb as that, I mean, I think he would cover it really well, actually. I'll let you hear it after that. You'll agree with me after you hear it. Like, you hear it, the more you listen to it, like, man, Tom Waits would do a really good version of the song.
Okay, I gotta look at this one real quick, because this is where I used to go to church with my great-grandmother. That's pretty wild. First Methodist Church in Bristol.
Like the ugly power lines.
Yeah, man, the power lines. I just don't understand. Why did you not put them underground?
Earthquake, baby. Groundhog. I don't know. I just really try to assume that I'm not that smart. That I'm like, you should have buried all these things. But I mean, like, there has to be a reason.
A lot of places they do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but is it because they can or can't do it here? Is it budget? Is it because
around here they do in a lot of places. The rich neighborhoods around here, they're all buried. Okay. Yeah, you don't have power lines in the rich neighborhoods.
I know they do it in a lot of places up north just because the winters are so nasty and it's not breaking power lines.
Well, it gets pretty sticky here. We did there for a long time before we stopped having so much snow. But when it does snow here, it yanks the power lines down because it's very moist.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And you've got the transformers exposed to the elements all the time when you could have them encased underground.
I give you a mayoral topic, and I think every single county should be having. I just don't
know. Get better pictures if you got rid of all these damn power lines.
Yeah. Well, I can get you make that happen. Just there vote for me. Okay. Why are these big power stations just wide open? Like, I remember once upon a time, they had to shut a town down in Longmont, Colorado, because a guy just got on top of the hill and started shooting a pellet gun at it strategically. And then once power was down here for like a day because a black snake got fried up inside one of them. It's like, why is that just open? To where a black snake can just crawl up in it. Why is it like that? Doesn't that seem like somebody could just strategically take out a power station very easily if they really wanted to? They're just sitting right out in the open like that. How hard would it be to put up pieces of tin all around it and then close it inside of a warehouse?
So you at least couldn't see it?
So at least you couldn't see it. So if at least a madman couldn't just drive.
Well, they had a couple over in North Carolina.
We have and just shoot the shit out of
them. Well, remember over in North Carolina, somebody did that a couple times this year.
That's what I'm saying. So why aren't they covered? Why do we leave our power stations just out in the open like that? It seems careless.
Why haven't the meth heads on Swimming Port Road stolen all the copper out of that one?
Oh, you're going to see it pretty soon. Meth heads are going to start carrying off like whole substations. Be over Urban Mail trying to cash them in. Looks like he's got a Tesla coil and a Kmart buggy.
I'm trying to look at it full page, but it's not letting me do it. But this is a ledger they found.
That's a neat
idea. From the Cameron Powell store.
Puts my hand
from 1834 to 1862. And they've got all his ledger. And let's just see what's on the... Wish it'd let me look at it full screen.
So you'd have to download it, and you can.
Okay, let's check it out.
Did you just come off alone?
No.
Okay.
Down. Ditto. Man, look at that handwriting.
I know, that's what I said. It's the handwriting immaculate compared to mine.
That says merchandise. Ditto.
He likes that Pokemon,
I did have a story I forgot to tell you. I don't know if it's good. It's too good for online, so I'll save it. That sounds like a red asthma or bronchitis one.
So I don't know what you could glean from this, but...
That our handwriting skills have drastically decreased over the years.
Elizabethan. This is from Thursday, July 17th, 1834.
My handwriting's pretty good, but only because Roger Arwood stressed that if you couldn't make your job application look like you weren't a hobo, then you probably weren't going to get the job.
Yeah, so I like
a whole week showing us how to write correctly.
Yeah, did you have a mechanical drawing CAD?
Yeah, until they replaced it with those computer classes that were BS.
I had mechanical drawing.
I had mechanical drawing, which is the big table and stuff where you're learning how to do, like you start out basically drawing. Drafting. Well, you basically draw gaskets over and over again for like 2 years until you start learning out like basic foundation work and like working on houses. By the time you get to 4 is when you actually do start drafting houses and stuff. And the 4th year I was in there, that's when the county decided to pull the class and show me how to use the magic wand in a generic Photoshop app to how to make a wanted poster of myself and stuff. And I was like, well, thanks a lot. This is dumb as shit. I don't need to do this.
So on Friday, July the 18th, 1834, Josh Renfro, Dr. Josh Renfro, sent his daughter in to buy 3 yards of ribbon for 19 cents.
Seems like it's, well, that's pretty expensive, really.
Here's a quarter pound of pepper for 13 cents for Thomas Badgett.
That's quite a bit of pepper.
Yeah. I like the weight better than...
What else we got here? Here's somebody getting his coffee.
Did you know?
63 cents for 2, what is that? 2 pounds?
2.5
2.5 pounds, of coffee. Yeah, 2.5 pounds of coffee. 63 cents.
Did you know British cooking? And the only reason is my wife's getting into pastries and stuff, they don't do like cups and stuff. They actually weigh it out because it's more accurate when you're doing like sugars.
Yeah,
stuff.
I mean, it would be because I never know. Like, cause they'll say like a heap, a packed a cup.
Yeah, like
of
a cup
flour.
Of it. They don't do that in all the British recipes. Yeah. Now. It actually has the grams of it.
I got something she might be interested in.
Do you now?
I got something.
Clips into swinging.
I got something your wife might like to see.
She wants to waste.
I have a Fanny Farmer cookbook. It is the Boston Cooking School cookbook from 1899.
Oh, actually, Boston. the Boston Market or something.
No, Boston Cooking School from 1899. It's called the Fanny Farmer Cookbook. And a lot of stuff I can't even make in it because like it goes down to like base ingredients. Like so instead of having Worcestershire sauce, it has like all the stuff that you put in to make Worcestershire sauce. And it expects you'll like be able to buy them, you know, at the store, like, because you would have, you know, 120 years ago, you wouldn't buy Worcestershire sauce. You'd buy, like, the whatever it is, anchovy oil, and mix it with the whatever else is in Worcestershire sauce and put it together. Well, same thing with, like your common condiments that you have. You just have the ingredients to make them listed, and it's pretty neat. I made a chocolate cake out of it, and it wasn't very good. but I can imagine, like, if you'd never had chocolate cake before, it's Boston, probably fucking banging, you know, but with me being used to modern chocolate cake, maybe it's just wasn't as good, was real, real bland and, you know, didn't have a lot of interesting texture.
No,
going
that
on.
Seems like British food.
Well, yeah, so it would have been the descendant of British food, yeah. So, but then it's, and then you get like
I like those posts whenever people show like they show a picture of like really shitty British food and they're like, I'm glad we got away from them. We're like, I thank Paul Revere every day.
Have you ever had a full English breakfast? I never have. With like fucking sausage and like beans and tomatoes and like
I had it, yeah.
I don't. I've never had that.
Yeah, it wasn't. It's just not what I want. I would call it hearty, and not for me.
Oh, Chris was one of the Chris family stores out of Michigan that became Kmart, and Alvin says they had liminal closets back then. Yeah, and Dumb Dads began on the Dick Van Dyke Show. Okay, yeah, so they really started it back then. But they, apparently...
Man, imagine to see how much way more functional he is now compared to, like, Jimmy Neutron's dad and stuff. That's how far down it went. Mm-hmm. All the way down to Disney, just deciding they didn't need...
Well, you look at, like, Kevin James or somebody like the King of Queens, like, you know, the dad and the... And by the time the 80s and 90s came around, the dad was the butt of the joke most of the time.
Tim Allen, Home Improvement.
Yeah, he was a dumbass who just fucked everything
just
up.
His way to victory somehow. Yeah. George Jetson.
Yep. Jetson! Yep, and you go all the way back in the 80s. What was the one I was just thinking of? Alf, the dad on there. He's just kind of a... No, Alf's dad... No, that's not the one...
that's a weird show.
Yeah, it was. Alf's, the dad on Alf was kind of like straightforward. Like stick up his butt kind of Law and Order kind of guy. But they weren't making him... Dad wasn't stupid, but because Alf was there, Dad was stupid. In a normal world, Dad wouldn't have been stupid, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But because Alf was there, everything was, you know, Dad didn't know how to handle it, so it was saying, basically, you throw something out of Dad's normal world at him, and he doesn't know what to do with it.
I really don't think anyone would, you know, with an alien. So,
yeah. Yep. That's true.
Do you know one of the things that broke that show was one of the very things that broke, Family Matters.
What's that?
Family Matters is more interesting because Family Matters actually went on a bunch of seasons and Alf didn't last that long. But, like, Family Matters started out as just a show that's supposed to be about just a normal family.
Yeah.
And it...
Urkel.
It wasn't... Yeah, it was not resonating with people. People were just like, normal family in Chicago. This isn't fun at all. And then episode 5, here comes Stephen Urkel comes walking in and... All apparently the black equivalent to whoever would be into like like Larry the Cable Guy, all those people went, that nerd sure is funny. Yeah. And the whole cast had to go, shit, I guess this son of a bitch is the star from now on. And poor Jaleel Watt really had to probably put up with a lot, but he seems arrogant, so I'm just playing. Apparently there was a big deal though, like probably was. like the poor guy did catch a lot of shit because he couldn't help that he was the star.
Yeah.
And without him, the show literally wasn't going to go on. Yep. And that was the same sort of contention that they had with Alf, that everybody was getting mad at a literal sock puppet.
So it's definitely, did I do that?
Yeah.
They really, really didn't like him, but I think they warmed up to him. But you can kind of tell they didn't like it. Like, if you watch him on later shows, like on like Dancing with the Stars and stuff, even with like that whole Stefan or Urkel character, you can kind of see the overcompensation of him going, shit, I don't want to be this unfuckable nerd my whole life that everybody hates. Even the cast here hates me. Laura hates my guts in real life. I'm definitely never getting any of that. So I'd say he did carry a complex with him.
You're right, Alvin. Before Dick Van Dyke, we had Father Knows Best, My Three Sons, The Rifleman, and many more competent dads, yeah.
Andy Griffith.
Man, I loved The Rifleman. He's always teaching Mark some good lessons.
Well, yeah, Andy Bill Griffith. Cosby. That was a little late in there.
Yeah. He still did have some competent dads, but overall, the studios were pushing for...
Now, son, we're going to learn how to drive...
Incompetent dads.
This is called...
No, Theo, you're supposed
to... Now, Theo, let me tell you a little something called Spanish Fly.
Theo, you're supposed to put the Xanax in the drink while the female is not looking.
Have you seen that creepy video where he sits there and explains?
Or the roofie
to the game show, the to the guy on the he's actually on a late night show explaining Spanish Fly to the host. And it's like, I don't know, man, I look back at that old stuff and I'm like, man, was it just that common to get like roofied?
I think you just openly talk
about it, and then I go back and watch like old school Shirley Temple. My head goes all to pieces.
No, you get roofied back in the like 60s, and you're like, damn, man, you got me. You got me again.
Ah, damn.
My butt hurts again. God, I got roofied again. Oh, man.
Well, maybe they just had like very adult sense of humor because it is TV that we're watching.
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, I mean, really, and honestly, it was a lot different than, like, people did not let their kids stay up and watch, like, a late-night talk show, for one, for the most part.
All the things that we downplayed, like, even, like, Archie Bunker downplayed race stuff, and then what was the guy that they basically... he was basically a wife beater that just never said it on camera. He's always throwing his tender
one
to the
moon. One of these days,
What was that? Right. Honeymooners. Yeah. Is that right?
Yeah.
Where he was always threatening to punch his wife, like basically hinting around that he did punch her off camera, but like
pow, right in the kitchen.
So you just look at it and you're like, was like wife beating just so common that they could just make a
there
whole
was
show
like
about
a whole
it?
Thing. There was like all kinds of commercials and stuff in that era about like basically wife beating and stuff like that.
So that's just wild to me that that's so real, or was it? I don't know. That's just crazy to me.
Well, I think, you know, the thing was that when you would, you know, make your wife, when you would say something to your wife, she would become hysterical, and you as the man were grounded in reality and had to knock some sense back into her, you know, because calm down, toots. You're being hysterical. You know,
he's in McClintock with Tom Wayne.
Yeah.
Where to calm her down, he picks her up and whips her with the fence. Like it's like a feeding spoon for a cow. It's how the movie starts, not how the movie ends. Yeah. And everybody's just like, yeah, that wild girl finally found a man that can tame her. It's like, well, pretty sure he raped her on the first time he met her after spanking her. It's like, God dang, what a crazy world it was. But it's a different kind of crazy that we're leaning into, so who am I to judge, I guess.
Alvin says, check out some pre-code movies before 1932, and you find out that during the 20s they were wide open compared to these days. Yeah, in the 32, I forget what the code was called, maybe you can tell me, Alvin, where they actually said, okay, we need to actually adhere to some sort of moral, values in these movies, because they're you had artists making things to start out with, and they
German film
kind of art was wide open, and people were making whatever they thought of. And the crazy things that you think of that we're making today, they made a lot of them way back then. But in 1932, they just got kind of so out there. Hollywood said, "Hey, we gotta have some kind of values based system here." And I forget, you can probably tell me what that code was called there, Alvin. I can't remember. And I'll wait around on that for a few minutes, and then we're going to get out of here, because we've been going for an hour and 45 minutes, and I keep dropping everything. Drop my phone, drop my cigarette. Everybody's leaving the chat, so we appreciate y'all being with us tonight. Be sure and like the video if you haven't already. Go and subscribe on YouTube. Follow on X.com or Twitter. It's not a porn site as much as Tim would like it to be.
We're going to be on fill-in-the-blank site here pretty soon.
Rumble. So go look for us on Rumble. We could get us an OnlyFans.
Rumble
site.
Should be porn.
You know,
like a porn site.
I mean, it really does. Yeah.
Ready to rumble, Tim?
Can you do all? I don't know.
We should do. We should see if we can do streaming on OnlyFans. I bet we could, and people could tip us. And our fans could tip us on OnlyFans, and their wife could see it. And
you get Twitch to OnlyFans. You got to bait somebody. You got to throw a hook out there to get people in somewhere. You guys got to let me work out a little bit before we do any OnlyFans stuff.
It's not showing up yet on there.
So the Hayes code. Thank you, Alvin. So whatever. So yeah. So no.
I ain't got no pics.
What were you just talking about?
OnlyFans, and only how fans. I need, how yeah, I need to work out before I start taking my
shirt off. Yeah, that's what threw me off, the whole the OnlyFans thing. So, yeah, you could leave us tips. And
I ain't getting no tips with this beanpole body at this moment. Look like Genie on Forrest Gump playing the acoustic guitar nude.
And Alvin, your wife, and Dalton, y'all could tip us on there, and your wives and girlfriends could be like, how are you spending all this money on OnlyFans? And then you'd be like, oh, I can't. I swear to God, I'm just tipping the Iron Mountain boys.
That'd be weird, but I mean...
It's like I'm tipping three boys on the internet.
Tim's got his shirt off.
The Iron Mountain of Hours is causing a spike in divorces in the Carter County area. Women just can't. They don't understand what's going on.
We can pull a DSP and have you pay to take your shirt back on.
Oh, me.
Have you watched this stuff lately? Mm-hmm. Well, he's melting down. Y'all don't care about this. He's having a meltdown right now because somebody made a documentary about him called The Failed Life of DSP. That's just the title. He can't get over the title alone. You're saying I failed at everything? Not everything. Poor guys.
Gundam needs to have a new rant on him. That's where I learned most of my DSP knowledge.
Man, I subtly think, and I know this is why I don't talk to people in normal life, I subtly think all those lol cows are some kind of a CIA program because they're all super active all at the same time. Like Boogie put out a documentary about how horrible his life is, basically. I don't know if you ever kept up the Boogie. Was it 2988 or something like that?
When he did the character of Francis.
Yeah, well, he's put out a new documentary here lately. Basically saying he's pathetic, he's broke, and you need to give him money. And it's like everybody's looking at it like, sounds like you're grifting again. You don't sound like you're broke to me. It sounds like you're grifting.
Let me ask you guys this. You ever get these, and I don't understand the purpose of these. That's what I'm trying to understand. So I can understand if you get a friend request or a follow on some social media, whether it be Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, whatever.
Okay.
And it is a young lady that you don't know. She's wearing something revealing, mm-hmm. and in most of the cases, you'll find, like, you'll click on it and say, who do I know this person? And it'll say, no, I don't know them. They're, you know, here's the link to my OnlyFans or whatever, mm-hmm. right? Well,
once you click on that link.
In a lot of these cases, though, there's no link to anything. I get these on Facebook all the time. It's just like uh-huh. one photo, a profile photo. They don't upload any other media. They follow or friend request. No links to anything. What mm-hmm. is the purpose of these accounts? Do you know?
I have noticed ones. A lot of them are hijacked accounts that, you know, people are stupid and they click something that's like, hey, help me get my profile unlocked mm-hmm. from someone I don't know. And then they hack all your stuff and
well, see that. Your profile. I can
and then
see
it
that.
Takes, like years later, like 6 months later to a year later. They'll start spamming people and trying mm-hmm. to do that. So they let it lay dormant so it goes falls out of everyone's algorithm. And then they're like, oh, they got everything off of it. So you can still see this profile has been around for 10 years.
Okay.
So you're like, okay, this person seems like they're legit. But you notice all the content from like 2 weeks ago. And then they start like spamming everyone.
All of a sudden, they start trying to sell people cryptocurrency.
Yeah, and I can see that, but no, I get those too. I get crypto links on some of them too. Yeah. But the ones that confuse me are just the ones that just it's obviously like, you know, it's some model's picture or something that they show, and they're trying to entice you to follow the account with a sexy lady, but. There's no other content there.
I think it's maybe some kind of like a, I don't know the correct word for it, for computer lingo, maybe some kind of an anchor to use that one to spy on you. So, cause I always noticed like my Instagram account, as soon as I got above like the 700 mark, I started getting, I would get five clusters of girls showing their asses and stuff all at once. And it was obvious that they were just girls trying sock accounts trying to get you to mm-hmm. the fans thing. And I would notice that they would all delete at the same time and then come back at the same time. Like it would be different girls. And so I think it's the same person operating several groups of people at the same time. Because the same group of people that was hooked up with those girls, I would always get one Indian dude trying to convince me to let him be my brand manager. So I don't know if he's hooked up with them. I also get these kids that are trying to sell art for super, super dirt cheap prices, but then you look at it and it's obvious it's just made by AI.
Yeah.
I have somebody try to steal my account at least once a week, so I can only imagine how bad somebody who has like 30,000 followers, they must be out on their front porch with a stick trying to keep pirates from stealing their house. Literally, all the time, people send me messages, hey, click this link. It's like, what? No. What is it? Some Pakistani guy smiling.
So, we're going to...
You'll eventually get to the point where you'll have Sniper Wolf on your front porch trying to fight you.
Elon Musk has friended me twice this month.
Yeah, he usually does.
It's like, the real Elon. Like, yeah, sure. Stupid. Like, okay.
So, this may be inappropriate for somebody, but we're going to bring us out on this one.
This is either awesome or awful. But I haven't judged yet, man. What is this? Send Vobs?
Mm-hmm.
I'm trusting you.
Don't do it. Will you show me nice pic of your buffs? You so butt you full, show me over Ghana. Send me naked pic, hello bitch lasagna. Your bobs very big, I'm kiss your bobs. In plenty it is well, nice your cock. Let's have sexy sex, cloth off. I am not doing sex with my mom. Fuck you as I can with my cock. I assure you can enjoy a lot. I want to suck your boobs. Put my ass in your asshole. Ooh. Baby, what is your boom size? Milk truck just arrived. Big boob girl, hi. Are you fucked tonight? I wanna kiss your vagina. For 2 hours, then put my 1 foot penis in your vagina. You will have me, wanna kiss your panty. Boobs are awesome, boobs are awesome. Do milk. Hi there, can you open up your cloth? Will you show me nice pic of your buffs? You so butty full, show me your vagina. Send me naked pic, hello bitch lasagna. Section is too good. Send Bob, stick off your cloth. So anyway, that's enough of that. That's enough of us for tonight. I'm sure that put you over the limit. We appreciate you. Definitely go follow us all those different places.
I didn't send you to another reality. Nothing.
With. That's right. And with that, we're out of here. Thank you for that very much, Dustin. Alvin, real quick, says those accounts are used by the network to monitor activity levels and node activity. The whole system is designed to grow the network and tie everyone together closer to engender activity so they can amp up advertising rate. Makes sense to me.
Makes sense.
All right, y'all. We appreciate you. Alvin, Dalton, everybody else in the chat there. That's who we mostly heard from.
Milk
Alvin
and Mama Dalton 666.
Tonight. Milk Mama 666.
Man, kill. Wilbur.
Yep.
It wasn't the name of the ball on.
Touch Wilson. Bob 69.
Wilson was
the. Wilson. Yeah. Wilbur was the horse. No, the man.
Wilbur.
Dr. Ed. Mr. Ed.
Dr.
Wilbur.
Man,
Dr. Ed, medical horse.
You guys don't want to be up in here. Oh, it's a confusing labyrinth.
All right,
off camera, I'll tell you something about the movie Labyrinth.
All right, sounds good. I can't wait for that. We'll see you later, guys.